Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Reema Gupta from University of Delhi. Today we are going to discuss about the module dry pressing from paper ceramic processing. So students, let us see what we are going to learn in this module. So first we will be learning about dry pressing, powder compaction behavior and Dywall effects in dry pressing. Then we will be moving towards elastic spring back and defects in dry pressing. And last but not the least, we will be discussing about isostatic pressing. Several techniques are used to compact or consolidate a powder into a grain body. The choice of the technique depends upon several factors, and these include product characteristics such as size, shape, desirable microstructure, dimensional tolerances, surface finishing, etc. Factors such as capital investment required and cost of manufacture also have to be considered. There are various ceramic forming processes which can be grouped under the following four categories. First is dry pressing, second, plastic forming, third, casting, fourth, molecular polymerization processing. Dry pressing is commonly used for coarse powders or fine powders which have been granulated into coarse granules by spray drying or other techniques. The applied stresses in this process are quite high, about 20 to 200 megapascal. Under plastic forming category, that is second category, this comes under the processes such as extrusion, injection molding, pressure casting and jiggering. In these processes, a large quantity of liquid is present in the pores so that the degree of pore saturation, that is DPS, defined as the fraction of pore volume filled with the liquid, is in the range of 0.9. During forming, the liquid in the pores is under pressure and exerts a back pressure. The forming pressures used are lower, which is of the order of 1 to 20 megapascal. The third type, that is casting. In casting processes, the DPS is greater than 1 and the pressures are less than 1 megapascal. The fourth category, that is molecular polymerization processing. In this category, the most important process is Sol-Gel processing, which is commonly used for the preparation of thin films and powders, but can also be used for the preparation of bulk shapes, that is monoliths. So, in this module, we will be discussing the process of dry pressing, which is a very common process for powder consolidation into a grain body. To recall again, the grain body have low density and low strength. In dry pressing, we are using the rigid dies, and dry pressing is a versatile and very commonly used method for the consolidation of powders into grain body. A wide variety of products including magnetic and dielectric ceramics, fine grain technical alumina, example spark plugs, cutting tools, grinding wheels, etc. are manufactured using dry pressing. In dry pressing, the powder is confined in a rigid die or a flexible mold as shown in this figure in case of isostatic pressing, and simultaneously compacted and shaped into desired shape. The technique of isostatic pressing is discussed later in this chapter. We will first discuss the pressing of powders in rigid dies, usually made of hardened steels. So in this case, the pressure is of the order of 20 to 200 megapascal in case of dry pressing, and the thickness is approximately 0.5 mm. the tolerance is of plus minus 1% in mass and plus minus 0.02 mm in thickness. As shown in this figure, the powder is pressed using rigid dies using top punch and bottom punch, which are on the either side of the dies. So, powder characteristics. In automatic machinery, the powder is fed mechanically to the die. A free-flowing powder is therefore essential. Fine powders are otherwise desirable because they sinter more easily, but such powders do not flow well, do not fill the mold well due to solid bridging. To resolve these conflicts, the fine powders are first granulated into soft granules having size of 40 mm to 500 mm by spray drying or some other parameters. Several additives are added to the powder to facilitate dry pressing. These are binders, usually used as water solutions. They provide enough strength to the grain compact for handling prior to sintering. Common binders are lignosulfonates, residues from the sulfites paper processes, dextrins, starches, cellulose, PVA, that is polyvinyl alcohol, and so on. The amount of binder is usually 0.5 to 5%. Internal lubricants. These lubricants help the particles to slide and rearrange during dry pressing. So, some of the examples are waxes, paraffin, and polyethylene glycol. Mold lubricant is another binder. They reduces the die-wall friction, and some of the examples are stearic acids and colloidal graphites. In case of powders, to be made into granules by spray drying, the desired additives are mixed in spray drying slurry. Otherwise, they are mixed with the powder as a solution wherever possible. So, we will be discussing about powder compaction behavior. Consider the pressing of spray dried granule in a die. When the granules are filled in the die and the die is stabbed lightly, the mass of the powder divided by the volume occupied by the granules gives the quantity called tap density or full density. It is expressed as a fraction of the theoretical density of the powder, and usually it is much below 0.5. There are two kinds of pores that are present in the powder. The pores between the granules are called intergranule pores, and the pores between the particles within each granule are called intragranule pores. Both types of pores are shown in the next slide in the figure. The former are much larger than the latter. As the punch presses the powder, at first the granules move and rearrange themselves. A slight densification above the fill density may occur. This is called stage 1. On increasing the pressure, at some point the granules begin to fracture and larger intragranule pores are eliminated. The granule deformation occurs by sliding and rearrangement of individual particles within the granules. The pressure at which this step starts is called the yield pressure, as shown in this figure. The yield pressure is low for soft granules and high for hard granules. With large quantity of binder and higher of granules with low quantity of binder or inadequately plasticized binders. As the pressure is increased further, the density increases. This comprises the stage 2. The relation between The density and pressure in case of stage 2 can often be expressed by the following relation. D subscript C is equal to D subscript naught plus M natural log of P subscript A divided by P subscript Y, where D subscript C is the compact density at any instant, D subscript naught is the initial compact density, P subscript A is the applied pressure, and P subscript Y is the yield pressure. After stage 2, the density increases very little. This is termed as stage 3. Some boundaries between the granules and some intragranule pores may persist to the end of pressing. The behavior described above is for granulated powder. For the bulk powder or for granules with different characteristics, the behavior may be different but on similar lines. Dye wall effects in dry pressing. So first we will be discussing about pressure variation along the depth of a workpiece. Let us consider the case of a powder being pressed in a cylindrical die as shown in figure A. Consider a slice of thickness dh through the compact as shown in figure B. A horizontal pressure is generated because of the constraining effects of the die. The friction at the die wall then causes the generation of a shear stress at die wall. The friction stress is given as tau friction is equal to mu p subscript h, which is also equal to mu k p, where k is equal to the ratio of p subscript h and p. The value of k is of the order of 0.4 to 0.5. P is the pressure applied by the punch. Now consider the equilibrium of the forces on the die. So at equilibrium, summation of all the forces will be 0, that is pi d square by 4 into P minus PB is one force, and the second force is mu pi dP kdh is the second force. So the sum of these two forces will be 0. Here P subscript B is the back pressure exerted on the slice as shown in this figure. Therefore minus dP is equal to P minus PB, which is equal to 4 mu kp dh divided by capital D. Now on solving the desired equation, we get capital P subscript h is equal to capital P subscript naught exponential bracket start minus 4 mu k divided by D into capital H bracket close. Here capital P subscript h is the pressure experienced at depth capital H, and capital P subscript naught is the pressure at the bottom surface, that is the pressure applied. It can be seen that due to the die wall friction, the pressure at depth H decreases as H by D increases. The exponential decrease in the pressure as the depth increases implies that parts with large H by D cannot be made using die pressing, because after a certain depth, the pressure will not be sufficient to compact the powder. This behavior can be seen in the figure. Similarly, if H by D is greater than 5, the compaction is unsuccessful. Therefore, long tubes, rods, etc. cannot be dry pressed. For best results, mu kh divided by capital D should be small. Usually, using bidirectional pressing, that is from top and below using two punches, parts with larger H by D can be pressed. Pressures profile in the palate. In the previous derivation, the pressure at a depth is assumed to be constant throughout the diacross section. In fact, because of the friction effects, it is not so. This can be seen in figure A, which is shown above, in which the pressure profiles through the vertical section of the workpiece are shown at an early stage of pressing at a later stage. It can be seen that the pressure across a horizontal section is not constant. The maximum pressure occurs near the top edge of the workpiece and decreases as one moves towards the axis of the die. Because of the die wall friction, the movement of the bulk powder is relatively greater in the center than along the walls. The amount of powder movement decreases as one moves away from the punch towards the bottom. These effects cause the pressure profiles as shown in the figure. Now we will be discussing about spring back effects, including elastic spring back and defects in dry pressing. At the end of the pressing cycle, the powder mass is elastically compressed. The powder compact springs back to zero elastic strain when the punch is withdrawn. Excessive spring back, that is greater than 0.75%, may lead to various defects, which we will be discussing in the next slides. So, when the pressure is released, both spring back to their zero stress position, and this is known as elastic spring back. Whereas in case of differential spring back, as the elastic moduli of the die and the pallets are different, the spring back amounts are also differential. As discussed in previous slide, excessive spring back may lead to various defects. So one of the defects is lamination. So when the boundaries are produced within the pallet, it is known as lamination, and there are various reasons behind the lamination. So it can be high die wall friction or low strength of the pallet due to less binder, gradients in the transmitted pressure, gradients in the stored elastic energy, non-uniform granules, non-uniform filling, or compressed air. So from this figure, it can be seen that at some boundaries, there are defects. The second defect is end cap defect. A cap from the top separates from the pallet. This is known as end cap, and this happens when there is a high average spring back of the compact and there is a high die wall friction. The next defect due to spring back is ring cap. In this, a ring-shaped piece separates out from the pallet as shown in the figure, and the reason behind this defect is the ejected corners having a high differential spring back. Isostatic pressing. So, in dry pressing in rigid dies, long shape like rods and tubes cannot be pressed. Also, due to pressure gradient, the grain density achieved in the part varies throughout. This may lead to differential sintering and other defects. To overcome all these problems, the static pressing is used, in which the pressure is applied through a fluid in a flexible mold in which the powder is filled. The pressure used is in the range of 150 to 200 megapascal, with pressures as high as 500 megapascal being used in wet bag isostatic pressing for production of large parts. The isostatic pressing is carried out in two ways. One is wet bag pressing and the another is dry bag pressing. Wet bag isostatic pressing. In wet bag pressing, the mold is separable from the pressure chamber. The mold is made of a flexible material like synthetic rubber, silica rubber, or polyurethane, as shown in this figure. The mold cavity is shaped in the shape of desired product. The mold is filled with the powder. It may be vibrated on a vibrating table to fill the powder uniformly. The mold is then immersed in the pressurizing fluid in a pressure chamber and the pressure is applied. The mold is then pressed from all the sides. This results in the reduction of die wall friction and the effects due to large H by D value. After pressing, the pressure is released slowly and the mold is taken out. The part separates from the mold and can be taken out as shown in the figure. Dry bag isostatic pressing. In dry bag isostatic pressing, the mold is attached to the pressure chamber and the fluid is present between the mold and rigid chamber walls. The process is the same as in the case of wet bag isostatic pressing as discussed earlier. The only difference is here the pressure is applied radially by the fluid as seen in this figure. The powder is granulated into soft granules using a soft binder for the purpose of isostatic pressing. This is because the shear stresses produced which cause the breakage and deformation of the granules, which are weaker during isostatic pressing than those produced during die pressing. Parts having complex shapes and large sizes are produced by wet isostatic pressing, while the examples of the parts produced by dry isostatic pressing are medical prostheses, spark plug insulators, grinding media, and hollow tubes. So students, let us summarize the module what we have learned in this. So the first thing which we have read is dry pressing. Dry pressing is the most common method to consolidate ceramic powders into green body. So in this method, the powder is filled in a rigid die, usually made of hardened steel and compacted by applying pressure. And the pressure is of the order of 20 to 200 megapascal. Very fine powders were then granulated into soft granules having a diameter of 40 to 500 millimeter by spray drying. And doing this, we add binders and lubricants for proper mixing before spray drying. So during pressing, the granules begin to deform and break at a pressure called yield pressure. After this, the pressure increases as the granule deforms further and the pores are eliminated. During pressing, due to friction of the die walls, the pressure experienced by the powder compact decreases from the top to the bottom of the die. And due to this, some of the reasons are taking place, such as long rods and tubes with H by D greater than 5 cannot be pressed in a die using a single punch. This ratio can be increased by using bidirectional pressing, in which two punches apply pressure from top and bottom. So in addition, the variation in pressure along the length of the compact, there is also a variation in pressure profiles. So due to these pressure variation, the grain density is not uniform through the compact. So in order to achieve more uniform and higher grain density, and also to be able to press parts in a shape of long rod and tubes, the technique of isostatic pressing is used, where a bag called flexible mold made of rubber or polyurethane is used. The powder is then filled in the mold cavity and pressurized through oil in a pressure chamber. So, in wet back pressing, the bag can be taken out in the pressure chamber, while in dry back pressing, the mold bag is attached to pressure chamber. Parts having complex shapes and large sizes are produced by wet isostatic pressing, while the examples of parts produced by dry isostatic pressing are medical prostheses, spark plug insulators, grinding media, and so on. Thank you.